ado, please welcome Peter Redd.
And use them as props. As he said, this book is kind of hard to get. Most stores don't carry it at all. You can kind of only get it through Subterranean Press, and they only made 5,000 or 6,000 of them. So it is a good opportunity to get it. I'm not usually shilling my books, but this is one thing while I'll say that. We have a small group. I think a lot of people came to see me at Emerald City Comic Con, so maybe didn't feel the need to come out tonight. So it's intimate. We can just chat, open it up to questions kind of right away, and people can ask whatever they want. You can ask about writing. You can ask about my books. We can talk about Arrow if you want to. I'm right at the beginning of a tour, so I'm kind of haven't gotten my full author talk on yet. So this is a good warm up, I think. If anyone has a question, we can kind of use that to get started. If not, I can dance very badly for
them. Yay! I would note that Ellen Dotlin thought we were going to sing today, so.
Like a duet?
I don't know if it was a duet, but you know, she thought this might be a singing instead of signing, so.
I don't know if that's a good idea. I mean, if you want to try and do a duet, we can do something together, but I'm not singing alone.
I don't know, do you know all the words to Let It Go?
I do, actually.
Six-year-olds.
Yeah, I do. I have a six-year-old daughter, so
know.
We went to the sing-along version of Frozen far too many times. You had a question, though.
I'd much rather hear you sing.
Good job, Jeremy.
Do you have any, to start this off in a real way, do you have any idea, has there been any need inside you to write book 6?
Has there been any need inside me?
Yeah.
For any desire.
Here's how the numbering of the books has worked out. I pitched 5 books originally. Science fiction publishers buy books in threes, because if you're writing a fantasy, it has to be a trilogy, of course, obviously, because why could it be anything else? And so I said right from the start, here's my plan for 5 books. This happens, this happens, this happens, this happens. And they said, no one's ever heard of you. We're not going to commit to 5 books. We'll buy 3. And if it works out, then you can write as many books as you want. And if it doesn't work out, you're going to have to find a way to end it in 3. So I'd already written the first book, and I was maybe a third of the way into the second book at that point. By the time I got a little bit further, I had to make a call whether or not I was going to write as if I were writing 5 books, or if I was going to start cutting out plot lines so that I could close it out in 3 if necessary. And I talked to my agent, and I talked to my editor, and I just decided to roll the dice and write as if I was writing 5 books. So then when I got to the third book in the contract, and we went to renegotiate the contract with the publisher bought another 3 books. So now, as you know, if you know the math, that's 6 books. So the 6th book is already sold. So I could turn the series into a 6-book series, and nobody could stop me. But I made a promise to close it in 5, and I really want to keep that promise. And I already had to. Like, I have a plan for the 6th book as a standalone story set in the same world with some shared characters. That was originally going to be book 4 in the series, but the series got so big that I needed the space, and so I yanked that out and said, okay, we'll do that as book 6 so that I can have more room for the story that's building now. As it stands, I am still planning to close it out in the next book. The next book should wrap up the main storyline and, you know, the main character's storyline. However, I have not written that book yet, and it may be that at some point during that book, I will realize that it's gotten too big to be contained in the binding of a single book, and decide to split it or something, but I don't want to, and I'm 87% sure that I won't have to. So if that's the case, the sixth book is still open. So I have that standalone novel that might be the sixth book, and I also have a new idea for a new series that takes place a generation after this one in the same world, and so I might also start that with the sixth book and strong-arm the publisher into going along with it, since I've already started a new series on the sixth book and the last book of my contract. But both of those decisions are the things that I'm putting off until after I've written the book that I need to write, because what I really want to do is make sure that this series closes out strong, closes out the way I want it to, and has a satisfying ending for everybody. So making this fifth book perfect is the absolute focus of my attention, and I won't start really worrying too much about the other books until that is complete, or at least close to complete. So that's how the book numbering goes.
Sure. You sound pretty sure that you can end the fifth book, the whole series of the fifth book, and then have your fun sixth book adventure, which is separate with different characters. Does that mean you have the fifth book rigorously outlined and, you know, all of your mile markers, all your beats you have to hit?
Normally my writing process is to have a very, very detailed story skeleton. I think I'm like the exact opposite of Naomi. The last book had a 200-page step sheet, I call it, with every chapter laid out with a list of bullet points. This happens, this happens, this happens. Funny bit of dialogue. This happens, funny bit of dialogue. And so that file for the new book is maybe 64 pages now. So I have a pretty strong outline. I know how it begins. I know how it ends. I have some like bits of prose written here and there. But there's also like a kind of bit in the middle where like that's where the magic happens. You know, like I've known all along how it ends, and how it begins sort of depended on how the last book ended. And so as I was writing the last part of the last book, there were some things that were getting pushed from the last book into this book. And so I have the opening all laid out, but then there's still some room to grow in the middle. And so that's where the pretty sure comes in, where like I know these things need to happen, but if I suddenly get an amazing idea for something else that I can add in that will still get us to the same endpoint, I may have to explore it if it's that great an idea. The closing of the book will not change. Like I know who lives, I know who dies, I know how the major story problems are resolved. And so after this book tour is when I'm going to really hardcore get into the step sheet and have everything laid out in great detail before I start writing the prose. I find it's much easier for me to have that skeleton and know exactly what happens in every stage of the book all the way through before I start writing the prose, because the prose for me is, okay, now that I know what happens, how do the characters feel about what happens? Whose perspective are we viewing these individual events through? Now that we have a bunch of POV characters, a lot of times you have two or three characters, POV characters in the same place, and then you say, who's gonna be the one who's witnessing the events? Like, whose head are you gonna be in as these events are happening, and how do they feel about what's happening? Which character has the most at stake, or is in the most pain, has the most interesting perspective on what's going on, and that's usually who I'll follow for individual scenes. And so that is much more mentally taxing for me than just figuring out what happens. I'm very good at the plotting part, and then the emotion part, you kind of have to feel your way through step by step. And so that's where the prose writing is for me.
Have you always outlined in that much depth, or did you develop that technique?
I developed that technique. The first three novels that I wrote, the ones that I did not sell and will never sell and no one will ever see them ever, 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 I made up as I went along. I think every writer starts out that way, and then you kind of find what works for you. But what I found is that I would write myself into a corner, and then I would either have to go back and cut out big chunks of things and throw them away, which I never liked to do, or I would have to find a way to work with something that wasn't the way I wanted it. And so I started outlining more and more with each book. And then I wrote the first version of The Warded Man, the version that did not sell, was written mostly as a discovery writer. Like, you know, I sort of made it up as I went along, and it went off the rails. And when I showed it to an agent, he didn't want it. And we had a long talk about what was wrong with it, and when I decided to fix it, I threw out probably 60% of that book, and then rebuilt it from the ground up. And that was the version that sold. And when I did that, that was when I started plotting everything out in advance so that I wouldn't get into that position again, where I had a book that started out really strong and had a great idea, and then went off the rails at the end and had third act problems, as we call it. And I was also, at that time, writing on my phone, like on my commute to and from work. I had like a smartphone and I was writing there. And so I would have to be really focused and know exactly what I was working on. And so I would have like bullet points of like, this is what you're gonna write during this time. And that really worked for me. And I started building that into what I now use as a step sheet to get through it all. So yeah, it came over time. I found that making the story up as I went along just led me to problems that I was not, my OCD would not allow that. So now I kind of have to plot everything out in meticulous detail.
You typed part of a novel with a smartphone.
60% of a novel, so probably 80,000 words or so. Over the course of a year, writing in 2 45-minute blocks, one in the morning, one in the afternoon, 5 days a week, while I was commuting. I was very committed at the time. I don't know that I would be able to do that now.
Is it a phablet?
It was, this was 2005, 2006. So it was an HP phone that had like actual buttons where you could feel the button click when you press it down, and it had a nice big screen, and it opened up a version of Microsoft Word. And what I really liked about the program Documents to Go, which I still use, is you can work on your phone and then sync it, and then you can work on your iPad and then sync it, and you can work on your desktop, because you keep using the same file the whole way through. So I could work on my phone, take it home, sync it to my desktop computer, clean up all the typos that I made on my thumbs, and like write a little bit more, and then sync it back to the phone and work on it again. And so I set a goal of 1,000 words a day, and so I would write 350 to 400 in the morning, 350 to 400 on the evening trip back home, and then I would write the rest after dinner that night. And I did that for a year before I had that final version of the book. As I said, you know, like, I was a younger man then. I don't know that I would be able to do that now. Certainly now that I'm a kid, I wouldn't be able to do that sort of thing. But
I expected your thumbs to be muscular.
They're just normal thumbs, but the thing is, if you force yourself to write large blocks of text on any device, you will eventually get faster. I mean, like, anything that you practice, you'll get better at. And so now, and it's a skill that's paid off for me now, because in the time that it takes someone else to text LOL, I can write a paragraph. And so it's made me very adept at instant messenger.
I remember when you came out with The Warden Man, and you had talked about living in a like post 9/11 New York as being kind of an inspiration for the demons coming out at night and the fear that was prevalent in the world. How did that change over writing the series?
Okay, so The Warden Man was very heavily influenced by September 11th. I think that I knew that I wanted to write a book about demons. I kind of had the magic system worked out before the event, and then I was in Manhattan when the towers fell, and sort of saw the chaos on the streets and saw how everyone was terrified and everybody reacted to it differently, and that fascinated me. And so I like the idea of the demons as the enemy that you couldn't fight. Like, they're immortal, they're immune to regular weapons. And so the wards that people use to defend themselves are wards of protection that basically form a barrier. But you can't fight back. You have to hide. And you have to hide in terror, knowing that if you screw up your warding, the demons are going to get you. And so it became about, how do the humans treat each other when they're trapped together like this? Like, what does that do to human interaction? And that was the real story. The demons were kind of a backdrop for most of the beginning of the book, at least. Sort of like the way the zombies in The Walking Dead are backdrops. You know, like, the real drama is the human drama. That's what people are interested in. The zombies are just sort of there as dressing. And it's interesting how world politics have really influenced the story, not in a direct way, but in a sense of, I was so suffused with what was going on in the world as during the period that I was writing those books. The Desert Spear is heavily influenced by that, because we take the character that is the antagonist in The Warded Man, and we restart the Desert Spear with him as a child and an innocent, and we go through his story, and you find yourself rooting for him. You find yourself, when he encounters a problem, you want him to solve it. And when we kind of sync back up with the first book, and you see the betrayal that made this character the villain in the first book, but through his eyes, you realize that there was more going on there than you first thought, and it was kind of this study of the other, we tend to villainize any culture that we're at war with and treat them as less than human, because you have to do that if you're going to be fighting them. And that leads us to sort of make broad generalizations and assumptions and the Russians don't love their children like we do, and that sort of attitude is something that I wanted to explore and kind of fight against by deliberately making you root for somebody that you thought was the bad guy. So that was the second book. And then by the third book, it was more the ongoing soap opera that forms with any series had led a lot of the characters to be in relationships. And so it was a lot more about how relationships change the people that are in them and influence them in ways that you don't expect. And also the sort of clash of cultures, where when you have two cultures that are at war with one another, and you see this throughout history, their cultures start to blend together. There's a bleed, like a Venn diagram between the two, where because you're constantly interacting with this other culture, you begin to take on some of the traits. Like, you take on some of the positive things, and you take on some of the negatives as well. And so, you start eating the food that the enemy eats because that's what's available when you're on the battlefield, or you start learning about their holidays, or learning about this, or learning about that, and that comes home. And the title of the Daylight War, a lot of the actual war happens in the next book, The Skull Throne, but the reason that it's titled that is because you start seeing the cultures blend together as they clash, and that is the more subtle war that goes on anytime two cultures fight. Dwayne, did you have a question too?
I was curious, because authors not just the Panzers versus the Polishers, a lot of authors will say that the character won't do things they want to, they'll run away with the book and so on, to say, no, my character is going to do that. I was curious if you were another author, the character will do what you want.
It is a rare and wonderful thing when characters don't want to do what the author wants them to do, because that's when you know that they've become fully realized in your mind. It doesn't happen often, because usually I work that stuff out earlier on, but it definitely does happen. And so there's two instances. There's one character, there's character Leisha Paper, who's kind of the one who usually will go against what I want her to do. And her mother, who was originally sort of meant as an antagonist character in the first book, suddenly started stealing every scene that she was in, to the point where, I just want to write about her, even though she's not one of the big movers and shakers in the thing, but every time she's in the room, all attention goes to her, and rightfully so, because she's awesome. And so it would be interesting, because I knew that any time I threw her in the room, whatever my plan for that scene was would get derailed, because she's one of those people that just speaks whatever's on her mind without any fear of repercussion, and that forces people who are usually closed off about what they're feeling inside to just sort of deal with something in their faces. And so that would frequently alter a scene in a way that I didn't anticipate. But particularly in The Skull Throne, I had a plot for Leash of Paper that involved her. I don't want to give away any major spoilers here, but I had a plot that involved her keeping a secret, a very powerful secret that would hurt some people when the truth came out. And the truth was kind of going to come out inevitably, but it was in her best interest to keep it for as long as possible. And when the time came where she had to make the choice of whether or not to keep the secret, the character just rebelled on me. She was like, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to hurt all of these people around me, excuse me. I'm not going to do that. And then I was faced with, like, wow, if this secret gets out now, it changes a lot of story threads. And I just, as a writer, I just had to deal with it, because when you get that sense that, like, the character, when you get that sense that you have to force a character to do something they wouldn't normally do to fit the plot, you're making a mistake as an author. And some authors don't care and are willing to make that mistake, but then the readers sense it. And I didn't want to do that, and so I had to rewrite a lot of things in order to make that happen, and I think the book is much, much stronger because of it. And when I look back and I think how I originally wanted it to go, that would have been a mistake. It would have been a weaker book. And so it's good when that happens, but thankfully it doesn't happen too often. Anybody else?
So you were talking about your novellas, how they're kind of like scenes you started that you had to, like, you didn't have room for, but you still loved it, so you made it into a novella.
Mm-hmm.
How can you, like, just take a part of your story that you love and just, like, rip it out of the book? Like, how do you make that decision of what needs to be cut?
Well, the first novella, the way the first book works, and the way most of the books work, actually, is I take the protagonists and I show you them as children, and I show how an encounter with a demon scars them and sort of changes their life in a very significant way at a young age. And then we jump forward a few years and we see them a little older, and we see how their life has changed because of that event in their childhood. And then we jump forward again and we see them as a young adult, and that's sort of when, you know, the meat of the series is occurring. And so when you do that, when you jump forward 7 years or 5 years or something in the story, you have, like, okay, what happened in those years? And there's one period in The Worded Man where there's a gap where you don't see the main character for about 3 years, but it is presumed that during these 3 years he's traveling around and having adventures. And so that's, like, sort of like a very rich time that I had always meant to mine later for, like, for story ideas, and it's before the magic in the series ramps up, so it would be very sort of like low magic adventures, like sort of, you know, cowboy rides into town and there's trouble, and, you know, and so I always intended to write adventures there, but then there was one point in the story where, because of that time jump, I had to sort of skip ahead past something that was sort of important, because if I wrote out the whole story of how the character got to this significant place, it would have thrown off the vibe of the book. And so I decided to write that as a short story, and then I tried to get that short story published, and most of the short story market was like, well, we don't want something that's a piece of your larger story, of your larger series. So, like, the magazines that normally publish fantasy short stories weren't interested. My publisher wasn't interested because they don't publish really short books, and so I reached a point where I couldn't give the story away. And then Subterranean Press, which is this small publishing company that makes sort of like boutique collector's item books, came to me and said, hey, we read your first book, we love it if you would write a novella for us so that we could you know, make a limited edition book of it. And I was like, well, it just so happens I already have one. Here you go. And it was this amazing opportunity. And that book, The Great Bazaar, I love that little book. And they only printed 1,000 of them because it was a very early stage in my career. And now those books are selling for $800. There's a special edition version with a leather cover that's selling for like $1,200 because there's only 300 of those. And I've been working very hard to get to make that book more accessible, and so I had to wait till the contract. Like, there was a certain period where I wasn't allowed to do anything with it until the contract was up. So now that that's up this year, that book and the next novella that I did with Subterranean Brian's Gold are going to be published together in a mass market in June. So I'm super psyched for that, because I think that you don't need to read the novellas to enjoy the longer series, but they enhance greatly those books. I think The Great Bazaar in particular makes reading The Desert Spear a lot richer, because you see some important bits of information that you don't have otherwise. And then Messenger's Legacy, this one ties directly into the Skull Throne. There's a character introduced here who becomes a POV character in the Skull Throne. You don't need to read this book in order to enjoy that, but you get a lot more depth of the character if you do. This grew out of a short story that I wrote for Unfettered, Sean's anthology. The first third of this is the story that's in Unfettered, and then the rest of it is sort of expanding on that. And then it starts with the character at 6 years old, and this book ends with him at 16, and that's where he picks up in Skull Throne. And so it's all tied together in a way that is very carefully designed, so that you can read the novellas without having read the main series, and you can read the main series without having read the novellas. But if you read it all together, it's sort of a richer experience, and it's good. Because I take so long between books, it takes me about 2 years to write a book. If you need a quick, like, while you're waiting for the next book, the novellas are a good way to get that.
So on that note, will we get another novella between the two books?
Yes, there will be my plan is, for the foreseeable future of my career, to write one novella in between each major novel. And so there will be another one that will probably come out right before book 5 comes out, and so forth. I have plots for maybe 4 more novellas. They take maybe a month to 6 weeks to write one, and so I'll usually do it in like the lull between books, or after, like this Messenger's Legacy I wrote after I finished The Skull Throne, and it was in production, and I had sort of like a waiting period while the editors read it and got me rewriting notes and everything. And so that's when I started working on the novella, and I'll probably do that again for the next one. Fine.
So will there all be novellas inside this series, or do you see yourself writing other novellas? Because like John Scalzi and Brandon Sanderson still sort of cleanse the novel, they call it. They often do, like, he does the Alcatraz books, for example.
I may do stories that are out of this setting, but right now I feel like I've constructed a setting that is wide and much of it is unexplored, and so I feel like I can tell pretty much any story that I want to within the setting that I already have. So unless some amazing idea for an entire new series comes to me, which it may, I expect that I'll just keep telling stories within the same world, because I have there's so much of the map that has yet to be explored. There's so many really rich, interesting characters that I haven't really fully been able to dig into, that I have a ton of stories that I still want to tell here. But if I get an amazing idea for something else, I'm going to go with my amazing idea wherever it takes me. So, you don't know. But that's the plan so far. Yeah.
Speaking of the map, FESA, is this supposed to be the last bastion of humanity, or is this a globe full of places that are so geographically separated that they don't know about each other?
Yes. So, in the series, we're dealing with an area that's about the size of Texas. So you have you have mountain regions, which are kind of cold, and then you have like a more temperate zone, and then at the bottom there's a desert, and then you hit the sea. And so you, like on all sides of the map, things are sort of blocked in. There's a mountain range at the top and on the side, and there's a sea at the bottom, and there's this huge, massive woodland to one side that sort of keeps things contained, and that's where the crux of this story is taking place. But I have notes on things that are off of that map. There are, like, it is a whole globe. There's tons and tons of other places, and the demon problem that plagues the characters in this book is a worldwide problem. And so there's entire other cultures that deal with the problem in completely different ways, and I have notes on all of that, and someday maybe I'll get to it if I have time, but in the same way that when you're watching Star Trek, like, you have one city on an entire planet that, like, you know, like, one ruler of the entire planet and, like, one culture and language for the entire planet, like, you can't tell an entire planet's worth of stories in a tight, cohesive way. The only person who's ever even sort of attempted it, I think, is Robert Jordan. And as we saw, that story got so sprawling that it was very easy to lose control of it. It was very hard to pull it all back together. So I think I'm going to close off this series, close off the storylines for these characters, and then I'll be free to maybe move somewhere else on the map and start up fresh somewhere else.
I'm just always curious about the element of death that any author puts into their world building, whether or not you have countries, like, just lists of things going on. It always is curious.
I have about 250 pages of notes on background stuff in the series. And so, like, every person, place, or thing that's mentioned in the series is in this glossary, but there's also a ton of notes of things that don't actually come up in the books, because this is, I think, a problem that a lot of authors have, where they get so excited about their world building that they design all of these complex things. Like, I came up with this detailed currency system, and I came up with this detailed, you know, like, way that this politician came into power, and that's why they do this. And unless those things serve the story, you're much better off just knowing them in the background and then maybe having one or two lines that you know are accurate and reflect that. Because if you just thrust all of your world building on your readers, you're going to bore them. You need to tell a good story. And all the world building should serve the story, not the other way around. And so a lot of times I think it's a problem that a lot of sort of budding authors have, is that they've done so much research to do their world building that they want you to know about it. And there's even a term for it. It's called I suffered for my art and so should you. But, like, just because you made up an entire language doesn't mean that your reader wants, like, you know, to go through, like, several books of French lessons in order to understand the story. You need to have the story come first and have that background stuff come later. You know, and, like, I should be so lucky as to be popular enough that one day they want to publish my appendix files.
Yeah. How did you go around finding an agent? How long did you have that before you were able to publish
your books? I took an atypical route. I went to a Science Fiction Writers of America party that my friend Mike Cole, who had written a bunch of short fiction stories, he was a member of CIFWA, invited me to the party as a guest. And I was basically there, like, kind of geeking out, because I was considered myself a hobby writer. I didn't think I was ever going to get published. I wasn't even really trying to get published because I didn't think I was good enough. And while I was at the party, there was kind of a big literary agent there, Joshua Bilmes. He's Brandon Sanderson's agent. He's Elizabeth Moon, and, like, he has a bunch of other sort of big name clients. And my friend was like, "Oh, you should go talk to him. You should go talk to him." And I was like, "I don't think my book is ready." And so I went over to him, and we were just chatting, and he was asking about my writing, and I said, "Well, you know, I've written these books, but I don't think they're good enough to be published, and I'm still sort of working on my craft." And he yelled at me right in the middle of the party. He was like, "You don't reject books. I reject books. You send me your book, and I will tell you if it's good enough or not." And he's like, "What are you going to do? Just leave it to gather dust?" And so I was like, "All right." So I sent the book in, and he promptly rejected it. But he rejected it with a very detailed letter saying, like, the book that you talked up to me at the party was not reflected in this because you had third act problems, because it looks like you made up the story as you went along. And he's like, there's enough good stuff in here that if you ever write another book, send it to me. And I had a couple of other books, we call them trunk novels, novels that you don't really expect to sell that you write when you're practicing your craft. And I had one of them that I kind of liked, and so I sent it to him, and he promptly rejected that too. But he took me out for coffee and said, look, there's some great stuff in your writing, but there's also, you're making a lot of amateur mistakes. Here's a book on writing, I think you should read it, and then I think you should go back and fix that first book you sent me. That book was The Painted Man. And so I threw out 60% of the book, started writing on my phone, and resubmitted that book to him after I'd rewritten it, and he called me up, and then I was like, he's gonna reject it again. If he rejects it again, I'm done. I can't keep going through this. And he calls me up, and he's like, this is the best book I've read this year. And he's like, we're going to market with this right now. And I was shocked. He's like, don't think that means it's going to sell. He's like, I'm not making you any promises. I'm saying, but I'm very excited about this, and I think I can sell it. And I was like, all right, well, you know, what's your success rate when you try to sell a book? And he's like, I've never not sold a book that I really wanted to sell, so I will sell it eventually. But don't get your hopes up that it's going to happen soon. A month later, he sold it to Random House. We actually had a couple of publishers that were bidding for it at the time, but Random House was the first and the most enthusiastic, and they were Terry Brooks' publisher, and I wanted to be Terry Brooks' publisher. So I went with them, and then he went on to sell it again in the UK and again in Germany, and eventually reached a point where there were enough international sales where I could just write full time, and I kind of needed to in order to meet the demands of the contract. So I don't think it works out that way for everyone. I was lucky enough that my agent was willing to take the time to say, I'm not going to buy this, I'm not going to represent this book, but here's why. And I think that you have the talent to write a book that I could represent, but this isn't it. Go back, work harder. Come back to me when you're ready. And that is something that a lot of agents won't do, and it's also something that a lot of writers don't like to hear. Writers, nobody likes to be told, your work isn't good enough, go get better. And what's that?
Which book I'm writing?
The book is called Writing to Sell by Scott Meredith. Scott Meredith was a very famous literary agent. He had an agency, the Scott Meredith Agency. And the book was basically him saying, you know, in 25 years of being an agent, I've sold, you know, this many bestsellers, and every one of those books had these things in common. So here's a list of those things. This is the skeleton of a best-selling novel, and if you do this like that, you know, this is the path to writing a best-selling novel. And I read the book, like, it was written in the 50s. It's kind of dated, and there's like all these sort of like sexist references in it that, like, it's just because, you know, it's like, let's say you're a homemaker, you know, I didn't agree with everything in the book, but it did flip on a light switch that wasn't, you know, like in a darkened attic, like flipped on a light switch and suddenly I was like, oh, I get it. And that really helped me with the rewrite of that book, and I don't think that I would have been able to put together the book that I did if I hadn't had that to work with. But I also had to have the humility to say, I'm not good enough yet, I need to learn more and go back and fix this. And a lot of writers, especially now, when you have the option to self-publish like that without any gatekeeper to tell you one way or the other, I think a lot of people don't like rejection, don't like dealing with the anxiety of having someone judge them, don't like being reminded that maybe they're not as good at something as they should be, and skip ahead to just publishing it themselves and do themselves a disservice because they could have made it better. They could have worked harder to make it better, but instead they were in a rush to get it out. And now it's out, but maybe not out in the way that they would have wanted it to be if they'd done that. I mean, certainly not everyone. There are plenty of self-published people who do have that and have put together like great books, but there are also, as you see, there's a million books on Kindle Direct Publishing, and I would say that probably 999,000 of them are people who skipped ahead because they didn't want to deal with the rigors that are necessary to make that last leap from amateur to pro.
So it was fortuitous that you met this guy and he wanted to look at your work. It doesn't always happen that way for writers who are starting out. And you were a hobby writer, you said, so
yeah.
It was more of a personal enjoyment that you built on the side.
I had a career, yeah. Like I was, you know, I thought I had my life planned and right. I didn't expect to be a writer.
Just so aside from beta reader number one mom, I'm sure now you have a group of other writers that you're friends with, or maybe even non-writers, like a group of 5 to 10 people, maybe even smaller than that, that you give first drafts to once you're done. Maybe, I don't know.
Yes, we call those beta readers. I have very few, and I think as the series has gone on and gotten more popular, I've gotten increasingly paranoid about beta readers. I play my books very close to the cuff. I have my friend Mike Cole, author Mike Cole, whose new book Gemini Cell just came out recently and is fantastic and you should read it. He and I have been friends for 20 years and sort of egging each other on as authors, and he was always my first line beta reader. I think there's a lot of him in my books, a lot of his influences, and there's a lot of my influences in his books, which is why I recommend them so heartily. And so he's sort of always been my front line. And then I have my agent, and I have my girlfriend, and I have my mom. And that's pretty much it. Sometimes usually with every book, there's like one, maybe two other people that I'll send the book to. But I found that like different readers look for different things. And between those different readers, like my mom is good because she doesn't read other fantasy. She doesn't have a lot of experience in the genre. So when she doesn't understand something, I know that I have to go back and explain it better. And she will also like get on me for every typo. And then I have my agent, who's like very deep into plot and story structure issues. And then I have Mike, who like writes very sort of like pulse pounding action novels, and he'll be like, this part is getting boring, this part is getting boring. And so like between those three, I kind of get a good broad look at how the book comes out. But I also, like, I'm very possessive of my work, and I even when people read something and suggest changes, I'll usually take the criticism of like, okay, I admit that that is weak, but I'm not going to fix it the way you want to fix it, I'm going to fix it in a different way. So, again, different for every author. A lot of authors have a ton of beta readers and want as much feedback as possible, and other people like to write in the dark and just have their formal editor, the publisher, do their editing for them. I've changed editors a couple of times at my publishers, and so I've never really developed that sort of artistic partner in my editor. But I have that resource elsewhere. So again, it's different for everyone.
We've seen a few hints and pieces about the way the world was before the demons returned. Are we ever going to see more of that, or see that flush out?
So the question is, are we going to see the way the world was before the demons returned? Not really. I make no guarantees about what I'm going to write in the future, and so I may have a wonderful idea for something that happens before the time of the return. In the series, we are in the year 332, maybe 333 at this point, after the return. So it's 332 AR. The return was when the demons came back into the world. So there was an ancient war with the demons 3,000 years ago, where the demons were thought to be defeated, and in that time after that, a very technologically advanced civilization kind of grew, and then the demons came back and knocked it back down into sort of Little House on the Prairie level of technology. And so there are occasional references to that. There are books of science that have been preserved, and so a lot of times you see characters who have access to scientific knowledge that goes beyond what their technology can produce. So, like, you have plans to build machines that there's no way you could ever build because you need other machines to make the parts to make the machines. But that's not something that I get into too deeply. You're never going to have a character find like an ancient iPhone. You're never going to have too much detail about that world before. I kind of like the fact that we never really know if it's our world or another world. I think that's a secret that's best left a secret because it adds to the mystique of the series. I feel like once you answer that question, you kind of take away some of the magic. But that being said, you know, someday I might have a fabulous idea and decide I want to write something like that. But I don't think so. I think that I'm going to be more or less sticking with moving forward.
I follow you on Facebook, and I see a lot of your posts are about your daughter. And obviously, I don't see a six-year-old running around here anywhere. So, how do you balance being a writer on the road, doing tours, and being a dad with a six-year-old daughter that you obviously care a lot about?
Well, I share custody of my daughter. My wife and I my ex-wife are divorced, and so we share custody every other day. So I get to see my daughter every day. I have a very deep and close relationship with her because I'm a single parent half the time. But it also, it means that she has a place to stay when I'm on tour, and I FaceTime her almost every day, and she's old enough to text me now, and so we text each other. And it was harder for her when I went on book tour a couple of years ago because she was much younger and didn't understand why Daddy was gone for so long. Now she understands and knows that, like, this is what pays for a lot of the stuff in her life, and knows that, like, you know, I miss her and we talk to each other all the time. And so, like, I think that I have an especially close relationship to her because when she's with me, like, it's one-on-one. It's worth that. Anybody else have a question?
Actually, bouncing off, but now that you're a parent, have you had any thoughts to write a children's book? Seems like a lot of authors are doing that now.
I don't know that I would write a children's book. I have been very strongly considering writing a young adult series set in the same world. Like, when I say, like, a generation, like, I'm going to write a story a generation forward, at this point in the series, like, a lot of the characters are pregnant. And so we actually have a couple of amazing fight scenes, one where it's a pregnant woman, and one where it's a woman carrying her baby while fighting. And so I figure, like, I've been thinking about skipping forward about, you know, 13 to 15 years and having those characters get to go on adventures of their own and writing it more as a young adult series. As you may know, the current Demon Cycle series is George R.R. Martin in its sex and violence levels, and so I would have to tone some of that back in order to write a young adult series, but I think I could do it, and that would be something that I could then introduce to a different audience, get them interested in my work, hook them young. But we'll see. I may still want to do that series, but not want to take out the adult themes that are in the books now. I have a really cool idea for that series, and I think it's something that no author has ever done before, and I'm kind of, like, really psyched about it, but I have a whole book to finish before I can start working on it in earnest.
Yeah.
I'm not going to tell you what it is.
Are you familiar with the Old Man's War series? Of course you are.
Yes, I am.
Did you ever read Zoe's Tale?
I did not. I only read the first one. I read Old Man's War. I have not read all of them.
So it's the other half of the same story that you get in the most recent final book of his series. He's obviously writing another one right now to cap it all off. But it's told from the daughter of the protagonist in all the books. And John Scalzi also has a young daughter who's of age with this female protagonist.
Sure.
And this, so I thought that was kind of cool because it seemed like he was writing a book that his daughter could really grasp onto within his universe. But it was also
it wasn't as adult themed as his previous work. So I thought that was really neat.
It does.
Parent author to do that. So
it sounds a little trite, but having children changes you. It changes the way you look at the world. It changes the way that you see a lot of things. And I certainly, having a daughter and like wanting her to like the same stuff that I like so that we can bond over it. Like, I'm not into sports. I'm into nerd stuff. I like comic books. I like fantasy novels. I like, you know, like, I like the action movie. And I want her to like the same stuff that I like so that we can bond the same way that, like, so, you know, other parents teach their kids about baseball or whatever. And what I've noticed is I've always kind of thought of myself as a feminist, but it's only when I sit down with my daughter to watch a movie or like read her a story or something where I'm like, wow, there isn't a single girl in The Hobbit. Wow, like Iron Man, you know, we were watching Iron Man 2 the other day, and you've got Pepper Potts, who's barely in it. You've got Black Widow, who is awesome at the end of the movie, but for the rest of the movie, for the first two-thirds of it, she's just sort of like, you know, the spy in hiding, and she's hiding in plain sight. And every other female in that movie is just an over-sexualized arm candy for Tony Stark. And the rest of it is all dudes. And, or you look at Indiana Jones, where, like, you know, he'll have one woman at his side who's like the romantic character, and then everyone else in the movie is a man. And I never really noticed it before. Now that I'm watching it with my daughter, I can't believe how bad it is. And it kind of pissed me off. And like, and that's something that has changed because I have a kid and because I'm showing her the things that I love. And like, I want her to be into Star Wars. And I look at Star Wars and I'm like, wow, the female representation in Star Wars is terrible. And there's one female character pretty much in the whole first trilogy. And she's constantly in need of rescue, or like put in a sex slave outfit or whatever, and like, is that what I want my daughter seeing? I'm not sure that I do, even though I love Star Wars. And she loves it too. Like, she watched the movies and she's not bothered by it, but I'm bothered by it. And that's something that I look back at my work and thankfully I don't see the same problem in my work. I've always had strong female characters throughout the series, but I think about it more and more as a creator, and I think that I can't help but have that influence my work. So, kind of went off on a tangent there. Does anyone else have a question? I don't know what time it is. Dwayne's standing up. We might be running out of time.
Someone will say we got time, but
anyone else have anything they want to ask? Bueller? All right, well, I'm happy to sign some books or chat as you come up or whatever. Thanks, everyone, for coming. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
I know it's Monday.